Summer of 2018, the temperature was 120 degrees Fahrenheit in rural Maharashtra, India. I was there as a healthcare entrepreneur on a mission of improving menstrual health and hygiene for low-income women. My team and I had planned an elaborate menstrual health awareness workshop for women from nearby villages. We huddled in a small public health center. It was 10 a.m. and the temperature kept getting hotter. Soon, there was a power outage, taking out our lone working fan. We waited patiently for women to show up, but we knew that it was too hot for women to even walk from their homes to the public health center. Soon, our healthcare worker spoke up. Women's health takes a back seat when surviving the heat is a priority. That moment made me wonder, all the good work that my team and I were doing in health education and equity was actually taking a back seat because of extreme climate events. Extreme heat was impacting the baseline health of women. And that is when I decided to move from healthcare entrepreneurship to climate investing a few years ago. The more I learned about climate change, I was surprised to know that how many parts of the world will be impacted by extreme heat. How capturing carbon dioxide from the air is becoming extremely important, and how dealing with natural disasters like wildfires and floods is becoming more and more urgent. At Stanford, we are encouraged to change the world and solve the world's biggest problems. But we typically look at new technologies and new innovations to come up with solutions. But what if I were to tell you that we need to look back at the wisdom of our ancestors to solve for climate change? So let's look at three ways in which our ancestors did something wonderful. How they were tackling extreme heat, how they were capturing carbon, and how they were reducing the risk of wildfires. Talking about extreme heat, let me start by asking a question. Which year was the warmest year in recorded history? Yes, last year. 2023 was the hottest year in recorded history. And what makes matters worse is all the 10 hottest years in recorded history have occurred in the past decade. Let that sink in. But what does extreme heat really mean? In central India, in summer months, farming communities start their day at 4 a.m. and end all outdoor tasks by 10 a.m. as it becomes impossible to bear the heat by noon. This not just disrupts their day-to-day life, but is also impacting their livelihoods. But there is a silver lining. Despite rising average temperatures, there are communities all across the world that have lived in extreme heat for centuries. And as people say, older the problem, older the solution. So let's look at one such solution in Rajasthan, India. Rajasthan is a very interesting state in India. 62% of its land mass is covered in desert, and it houses 82 million people. Hawa Mahal, as you can see, is a very famous palace in Rajasthan, which literally means air palace. Built in the 18th century, it has a unique honeycomb structure with 953 windows. By modulating airflow, the temperatures inside Hawa Mahal are 10 to 12 degrees colder than outside temperatures. This form of cooling, without the use of energy, is called passive cooling. Passive cooling and Hawa Mahal's architectural design has inspired modern-day architects all across the world. So let's travel a few thousand miles away from India to Harare, Zimbabwe. The East Gate Center Mall stands as a testament to the fusion of ancient wisdom and modern technology. Inspired by the design of termite mounds, as you can see, the temperatures inside are cooler without the use of as much energy. In fact, these buildings use a mere 10% of the energy that conventionally cooled buildings use. However, a critical question arises. Are ancient ways of living enough for solving our modern day technologies? Of course, we can't revert back to the old ways of living. But here is an opportunity to pave a path forward to bring the best of ancient wisdom with modern technology. There are advancements in material science, like you can see, which are low emissivity glass panes. These glass windows let natural light come in and block infrared radiation. Instead of using a single glass pane, designers are using two glass panes with vacuum in between to provide for better thermal insulation. And of course, AI. There is no conversation that can happen in Stanford without the mention of AI. Using artificial intelligence, there are glass windows that adjust in response to the day, time of the day and sunlight, blocking heat and letting natural light come in. In fact, there's another area where we can learn from the wisdom of our ancestors, which is capturing carbon. Of course, global warming was not really a problem for our ancestors. But post-industrialization, human-led activity of burning fossil fuels has increased the amount of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. This has led to retention of heat and global warming. These greenhouse gases stay in the atmosphere and retain heat. In order to reduce global warming, most countries across the world have pledged for something known as net zero goals. Net zero goals are basically commitments that the amount of carbon dioxide that these countries emit will be offset by the carbon dioxide that they capture. The amount of carbon dioxide which is emitted cannot be reduced to absolute zero practically. That is why capturing carbon dioxide becomes extremely important. There are billions of dollars that are being spent on technologies like direct air capture to capture carbon dioxide and permanently store it. Experts consider it as the most permanent and best solution to capture carbon dioxide. I know what you're thinking. Don't trees exactly do the same thing? Yes, and there are complications. There isn't enough land mass to plant enough trees to capture enough carbon dioxide to meet our net zero goals. In fact, there is a competing land use with agriculture, and with growing need of food production, it becomes more complicated. So how can we learn from the wisdom of our ancestors here? The answer lies in agroforestry. Agroforestry is a technique where trees are planted in the same ecosystem where crops are grown. The trees in an agroforestry system capture carbon dioxide from the air and store it in the ground, replenishing the soil nutrients, maintaining water tables, which in fact are good for the crops that are grown in the system. Agroforestry was practiced all across the world for centuries. However, pressures on food production forced many farmers to move to unsustainable farming practices. This not just led to land degradation, but is also a lost opportunity for carbon capture. So what do we do about it? The good news is, nonprofits recognizing this are working with local communities to promote agroforestry. At the same time, they're using technology like satellite imagery and drone-based monitoring to track tree cover and tackle illegal deforestation. This data is also being used to channel more funding from their donors. This data also helps in generating carbon credits. For those who don't know, carbon credits are basically a trading system where companies who cannot reduce their greenhouse emissions to zero can buy these carbon credits as an offset. This also creates an adequate funding mechanism for moving money from companies to nonprofits for better conservation efforts. There's another area of forests which is becoming extremely important these days, which is preventing wildfires. In California, we have seen the devastation that wildfires have caused in the last decade. Commercial logging practices have led to monocultures, which is planting a similar type of tree in large areas, reducing the forest's natural ability to deal with wildfires. However, indigenous communities in North America have long practiced sustainable farming practices. They knew which trees were more resistant to wildfire. In fact, they had a very interesting yet controversial method, which is prescribed burns. Prescribed burns are basically small and controlled fires to tackle large and uncontrollable fires. Prescribed burns require you burning a small area of land, which also helps clear some of the underbrush and recycle nutrients back to the soil. However, at that time, the population of Native Americans was only 1 million, and now California's current population is 40 million. And our world has become way too complicated. Imagine a prescribed burn causing an unintended damage in your neighbor's property. The legal and financial issues will be very hard to deal with. So what do we do? Luckily, startups realizing this are working with local communities to practice and learn more about prescribed burns. At the same time, they're using technology effectively to identify high-risk regions. By using satellite images, they figure out what are the areas which are high risk, like the parts of high voltage lines. And then they used mechanized robots, yes, robots, for prescribed burns. These robots go and clear small areas of land by prescribed burns and also douse out the fire then and there. These companies also work with insurance companies to deal with legal risks. So as we saw, combining prescribed burns with technology and integration with financial and legal systems, we can create an ecosystem to deal with wildfires much better. So we saw the benefit of learning from ancient wisdom of passive cooling, agroforestry, and prescribed burns. We also saw its potential in collaboration with new technology and integration with financial and legal systems. But as we confront a warming world, the resource-rich countries will be able to find a way to lead a good quality life with air conditioners, air purifiers, and robust financial and legal systems. But what does climate change really mean for low-income communities? These communities have contributed the least to global warming and yet would be the worst impacted by climate change. If we don't learn from the wisdom of our ancestors, we run at the risk of exacerbating inequality. So let's embrace the best of two worlds. Let's learn from the wisdom of our ancestors and co-develop solutions with local communities. By doing this, we not just solve for climate change, but also for equality. And that gives me hope. So let's learn from the wisdom of the past and the future, the tried and tested practices of our ancestors and the modern day technologies. So in order to solve for climate change, let us all turn back to move forward. Thank you.